You're far from home.
I am.
Have you been touring? This movie's been in more film festivals, more major film festivals, than any movie this year.
I guess so, yeah.
It seems like no matter where you go, and they usually exclude the previous film festival, they still want you.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's really crazy. Like, it was almost selected for Cannes last year, and then it kind of just... And then Cannes last year was cancelled, and then it was Sundance, and...
Right.
And then Telluride, Toronto, New York.
Has it been interesting for you? Has that journey been interesting for you, going to all that?
Yes, it has. And, you know, also the change, because it kind of started virtually everything. And then slowly, also the festival started opening up again. So first meeting the audience digitally, and then being on a screen later on, it's been an experience.
So when's the first time you saw it with an actual audience?
I saw it, well, for the premiere in Denmark and Copenhagen. But that doesn't really count, because, you know, that's friends and family, so I don't really trust them to be, you know, they would clap for anything I kind of had done. So I think the premiere in Annecy, we had a big premiere there and a big screen with a big room, and also because, you know, it's animators in Annecy, so people who really know the craft. So that was really special.
So what was the beginning of this? I mean, it seems like the beginning of it was the interview, potentially. But what was the first time you thought, oh, this is something I want to try to make into a movie?
I don't know. You know, I met him when I was 15 years old. And already back then, I was, of course, curious about why and how he came to my little Danish hometown. Mm. So I think my interest in his story started already, you know, 25 years ago. I asked him... background in radio documentary, and I asked him, I think 15 years ago, if I could do a radio documentary about his story, but he said no, that he wasn't ready.
You were doing podcasts before podcasts.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So you knew his story, you knew the...
No.
You just thought he was interesting and there was something going on.
But you know, I asked him, of course, about his past, but he didn't want to talk about it. And of course, I respected that, but it also triggers a kind of curiosity about it.
Right.
What have you been through? Also because I knew him so well. Like, we've been friends for many, many years. We've traveled together, we've been here together, we've been, yeah.
So what turned the corner for him, do you think?
I think, you know, when I asked him if I could do a great documentary, he said no, but he said that he knew he would have to tell the story at some point, but he just didn't feel ready back then. And then I was invited for this workshop called Anydocs, where they combine animators and documentary filmmakers and full of ideas for animated docs. And they asked me if I had an idea, and I then thought again, okay, maybe this is the way this one is doing. And I asked him, and he finally said yes. And also because with the animation, you could make him anonymous, which I think was kind of crucial to him, because it's so hard for him to talk about these stories,
right,
that he doesn't want to, you know, meet people in the street who've seen the film and recognize him and then want to small talk about what happened. He can't do that. So I think that really was a change for him.
So you connected to the animation idea before you even really knew what his story was.
Yes.
You just knew he was being secretive, but...
Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
And was his the only story you thought of when you...
Yeah.
As you walked into that world?
That was kind of the immediate idea I had. And I then asked him if it was okay that I brought the idea of turning his backstory into an animated film. And in the beginning, you know, it was like a short film. And then when he finally told the story and we started doing the interviews, and I started to kind of organize all the material and then doing like a script, I could see, okay, but this is not a short film. It just kind of grew and grew, and all of a sudden I had like a 100-page script.
So the movie doesn't really show the torture of coercing him or you know, needling him as an interviewer to get him to tell his story. How much of the journey was that before it started actually flowing and you started thinking, okay, now we're getting to the meat of this?
I think like in the course of like 3 or 4 years, I've been doing like 15, 20 interviews with him. And in the beginning, like I kind of got the broad strokes, but there were things he didn't want to talk about. Huh. So, you know, it was really a process of him also getting ready to kind of share everything. But because we know each other so well, it was kind of, It was a slow process, and from the beginning I knew that it was going to be a while. And he said in the beginning that he actually didn't care if it was going to be a film in the end. For him, it was really the process of telling the story that was important.
So did it come out in spurts and fits over time with you, or did you finally have one sit down where you went, where he just kind of gave up the ghost?
It was like the first couple of interviews were like long interviews were kind of, I got the broad strokes, and then afterwards I would get back to him and really go deeper in specific kind of situations and things he had a hard time talking about before. We would go back and kind of just slowly kind of go deeper and deeper into those.
And you're just that patient?
I think I am quite patient, yeah. But also, you know, because at the same time I was working on the format, like how to, the form of the film and how to show it visually.
Right.
And that was really engaging, you know, because there was always something going on and always new things to try out. But yeah, I think I'm normally quite patient.
But I mean, you're doing all of that in anticipation, and if it had only been a short, if you had never finally kind of exploded it all out, would that have been satisfying to you? Would you have been okay with that?
No, I think the ambitions kind of grew along with the project. So at some point, no, it wouldn't have been satisfying. In the beginning, I thought it was going to be like a short. But then when I kind of had the story there, I could see, okay, but this needs to be longer. Like, it wouldn't be satisfying to try to boil it down to like 10 minutes, 20 minutes. This needed to have a broader kind of, structure.
And did you need to know, as you're in the process of him telling you, I mean, it's a very human story, even though it's also a political story. Did you know enough to not have to figure out some of the things that were going on in his storytelling?
If I knew enough of his past, or
of the past, of the history of what was going on.
But I could kind of see how what he'd been through kind of affected him in his everyday, like in his life today.
Right.
So this thing about his boyfriend really wanting to settle down and him not being able to do so, I could see that he was still kind of fleeing. So I knew that there was a lot of material in the story that we needed to get out there. And that there was a story about trying to settle down and find a home that he hadn't done yet. You know, he was still searching for a place where he felt at home. So that was really the process. And I could see that either he would find a place that felt like home, or he wouldn't. Either it would be like a happy end, or it would be a tragedy. But either way, it would be a story.
Well, I guess the story of fleeing is really not specific to any one country or any one political situation. It's all identifiable.
Yeah, I think so. And I think his flight is very kind of, you know, going from Afghanistan to Denmark, but it's also a flight from his story, not being able to be honest to his past. Also, when he was kidnapped, being able to be openly gay, you know, there's always this kind of disconnection with who he was and what he kind of had out there. So it's very much, you know, also freeing yourself. And I think that's related for a lot of people, that you, like, this thing about finding a place in the world where you can be who you are with everything that entails, I think it's something that most people can relate to then, and that most people go through at some point of their life.
So when did you know you wanted to be a storyteller when you grew up?
I think it kind of happened gradually. Like, in the beginning, I thought I was going to do radio or maybe sound design for films. And then
it was just interesting to you, or what? I mean, it's a very specific area, sound design.
Yeah, but you know, I always loved music and I always loved sound, so I kind of thought. But the beginning was radio, and then you know, just being a DJ on the radio. But then it kind of grew into telling stories and telling documentary stories on radio and building the sound. And then from there, the first film I did was a documentary about my grandfather. And it was just, you know, he had just passed away and the family was gathered in his home and we were looking for the will. And looking for the will, I found these old VHS tapes with like old films that he had shot when he was young. And I watched it and I realized, okay, but I don't know anything about this guy. I know very little about him. And I thought, okay, I'm going to explore this and make it into a film. Mm-hmm. And I think that process really was where I felt like, okay, but I have a talent for telling stories and I really like it. So that's kind of where it really started.
Is there such thing as pressure in terms of going into a profession at home?
I come from a very artistic family, so I think it's not a big revolution that I wanted to make films. You know, my parents did theater. My grandparents were authors. So, I think going this direction, it was like my family was okay with it. I think if I had chosen to be in the banking industry or something, that would be more of a revolution than being a film director. So, I've always had a lot of support.
There always seems in Denmark a more of a kind of openness to all of it than here in America. I mean, there's such a there seems to be a grind that we're used to in America that does not seem to be the case for kids growing up.
What do you mean,
Just there's always, it doesn't seem like there's this, you must achieve this by this time, and this by this time, and this by that time.
Yeah, I think, you know, I guess Denmark is kind of a socialist country, so it's more of a flat structure. It's not, it's more of, you know, a community-driven society than an individualistic society. I don't know. I'm not an expert in societies like that, but it's true. I think the pressure is less so in Denmark, also because you always have, you know, the government or the country will always take care of you if things go wrong.
Was there in the process of making the movie and going through these steps, did you feel like at any point this is now something that's got this international worldwide potential for interest? Was it him telling you the full story? Was it the system that you had worked out for what it would look like and how it would feel? Was there a moment, or do you just kind of I made my film?
No, I think it was quite early in the process. Actually, we made this teaser where we did a proof of concept while I had done the first interviews, and we tried out to do some animation on top of the interviews, and we were invited to pitch in Annecy in France, and we won this pitch award that Disney gave us, which was weird because this is really not a Disney film. but there I could see that people could relate in another way than I actually thought they would be able to. And I could tell that, you know, the fact that people saw that it's the real voice behind the animation, you just sense that when we did the pitch, everyone was kind of just kind of sitting forward and kind of listening more, because it was something they didn't anticipate. So it felt like that's really where I felt like the international interest was there.
Were there other films of this style that you looked at and said, "Oh wow, that's cool"? Or
Wolf of Bashir is crown jewel in animated documentary, and that's really where I saw, okay, but this can be done, you know, and I thought. And actually, that the documentary story is really, heightened. I don't know.
Right.
Yeah. By the animation, that you could really have something strong, and the way of telling a documentary story with animation. That was the prime example. And then, Persepolis. And there's a lot of different kind of short films. There's some Swedish short films that I saw where I thought, okay, but this thing about having a documentary character behind animation.
And once you figure out how to do it, is it quote unquote easy at that point, or?
No. No, but it's never easy, you know. But it's hard work, and I was lucky to have an amazing team of really really skilled artists around me who would give me a lot of creative feedback, and I think it's really a team effort, and as long as you have a great team around you, a lot is achievable, and so actually the process was really amazing. Also because I'm used to working documentary and just having, you know, maybe a DOP, maybe an editor, but all of a sudden to have a big team around me was really amazing.
Do you consider yourself an animator now?
No. if I would have to animate this thing, it would be something else. I wouldn't be here, that's for sure.
Stick figures.
Yeah, exactly. No. I actually drew a small thing in the film just for fun. So there's my character's notebook in the end of the film. I drew that myself.
But it's an Easter egg.
Yeah, it's an Easter egg. It's red. It's in the bottom of the image. It's almost out of frame. But so I participated a little bit, but I'm for sure not an animator.
So when did you? What was there a particular festival where you got that? When you were completed, where the film was completed, where you understood that this was hitting an audience the way that it was? Was it over a digital stream of some kind?
It was. It was the world premiere in Sundance. Because that was the first time it really hit an audience. And, you know, our distributor kind of sent us these press notes, and I could just see that people really engaged in it and were moved by it, which were really meaningful to me because, of course, I put in all the work, but also to Amin, you know, he had seen the film, of course, and he said to me, like, he was very moved by it, but he didn't know if it was a good film because it's his story, so he would be very emotional about it. So seeing the film hit his audience and seeing the reaction was really meaningful to him.
Well, what did you guys see? Was there a way for you to get feedback from the actual audience?
Tweets.
Okay, so you're getting feedback from people who are sending feedback.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And you didn't have a distributor going in, did you? A domestic distributor?
No.
No. So your distributor from other country, from Denmark or somewhere, was giving you stuff, or was it Neon?
No, it was actually, who was it? It was, because Neon didn't come on until later. So this was, I guess it was like 30 West, kind of sent us all the press notes.
Yeah. So is that just weird at that point where you're not able to see with the audience? There's really no, I kept on thinking that Sundance, which I think they did a really good job last year, but I thought there should be like some sort of video feedback.
Yeah.
The filmmaker could actually watch everybody watch the movie or something. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know, it was in the middle of the pandemic was really bad at that point. So even in Denmark, we couldn't gather more than 5 people. So like the very core team of the film kind of met up at the production company, and we had a screening. But it was, you know, because of the time difference, it was like 4 in the morning. And you know, I was at Sundance, but at the same time I was homeschooling my daughter. So it's very schizophrenic, you know, this kind of very down to earth, like just getting things to work back home. And then at night I would be in Sundance. It was really weird, but a special experience.
Have you had any other experience before that with the kind of embrace that you're getting here at all? No, not really.
No. No, this is by far the film where I felt that people appreciate it and it gets a broad audience.
And are you ready to put out all your other titles again and so we can all see them? I was looking through your IMDb page and I was like, I'm interested in that documentary. I mean, they were mostly shorts, but I was really interested actually in some of them.
Yeah. No, but some of them are out there, I think my longer films, but some of them are, you know, are in Danish and not subtitled or anything, so that's going to be a hot watch for anyone who's not.
I think that's the biggest loss in America is that we don't see, the documentary films from other countries are so good, and they're so different than what we do here, really, a lot of the time. And it's really, I programmed the film festival 1 year, and I was just like blown away by all the stuff from overseas, and I was like, we never see this. I mean, Sundance now has, that section, but it's really not the norm, and it's kind of a shame. It's really a loss for us, I think.
Yeah. But I think it goes both ways. Like, it doesn't. Also in Denmark, we don't see. We see a lot of Danish documentaries and Scandinavian documentaries, but there's a lot of films we don't really see. You know, because there's so many good stuff coming out also of Asia and Eastern Europe, and that we never get to see.
So, do you see American movies at home a lot, or is it? So it's our studio movies, or like the Hollywood movies that kind of break through?
Yeah. You know, in cinemas, that's really kind of what's in cinemas.
And are people going to cinemas in Denmark now?
Yeah. Yeah, but you know...
How are things at home?
No, but it's good. You know, the country is fully open. There's no restrictions anymore. So it's... you don't need to wear a mask anywhere. But a lot of people is vaccinated. It's more than 75% is fully vaccinated.
Right.
And there's not a lot of cases at the moment. So it seems like things are going well, but
was there a horrible time at some point during all this, or was it?
I mean, lockdown was bad, but I think we were never really badly hit.
Right.
They were kind of quite early. They kind of made lockdown, so we had a lockdown in March for a couple of months, and then again around Christmas.
You guys are smart and take care of yourself. Which we can say for about half of America.
Yeah.
The other half, I'm not so sure whether we're ever going to catch up. It's really kind of
Yeah.
kind of horrifyingly brutal.
Yeah. No, I think we've done all right through the pandemic. It's of course been tough for a lot of people, and I think there's a lot of, you know, because people had to stay at home, there's been a lot of loneliness, a lot of mental health issues that I don't really know. I don't think we've seen how bad it's been yet, but I think a lot of people have struggled.
Were you already homeschooling your kid before all this, or was this?
No, this was all new.
But you took on the whole mantle. You didn't just like put her on a computer and say.
But luckily she's so young, so she is that the school is very light still. So it was supposed to be, you know, just playing. So the first lockdown was really about just having fun with her, and we were almost. I was doing the final mix in Norway. When the Danish Prime Minister kind of got on television and said that they were going to close the borders. So I just made it back home Friday, and then they closed the borders Saturday. And then I was like, okay. And then I guess
I'm home for a while.
Yeah. And my wife had just, she has a job where she works a lot, and they were badly hit by the pandemic. So there was a lot of work to be done to kind of make sure that they would survive. So I was taking care of the kids. But it was actually, I enjoyed a lot of time. You know? It was just hanging out.
There was something nice about it. So yeah. It's not nice, but
yeah,
there was an intimacy. So when did you finally get to see the film with an audience at a festival or somewhere?
But it was the local premiere in Denmark, and then it was
But you didn't trust. Oh, yeah. And to see you showed the whole movie.
Yeah.
Finally.
Yeah. So we had the premiere in Denmark, the local premiere in Denmark, in June 17th, and then the day after we had the premiere in Annecy, which was an amazing experience, because you could really tell. I was a little, you know, scared, because that's really people who know the craft, so they would appreciate it, but they really did, and it was really an amazing experience.
So do you think they were judging you more on the animated artistry or the story?
I think that they judged both, but what was so nice to see that they appreciated both things.
And when did you get to see it with somebody who wasn't either an animator or
a
home friend?
I've been to some festivals, but a lot of them have been, you know, hybrid.
Also
so there's
hybrid,
been very, very few audience in the cinema, and some people would watch it online. So I was thinking maybe it's Telluride, actually. Where I kind of saw it with a bigger audience.
So was that different than seeing it with an Annecy or at home?
It's always interesting to see how different audiences from around the world react differently to the film.
So they have reacted differently.
Yeah. I think especially, you know, the humor is different. So the Danes would laugh at something and the Americans would laugh at something else, which is fun to see. And there are things in the film that the Danes really appreciate that I think no one else really see.
Tell me something.
No, but there's this sequence in when Amin and his boyfriend is out looking at a house.
Mm-hmm.
And Amin is talking to a cat, and the boyfriend is talking about these hazelnut trees.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see that they don't really talk together, but they talk about two different things. And the Danes are just kind of, I think it's very kind of, but it's very much in the language, I think.
Right.
How he just keeps on raving about these hazelnut trees. So the Danes really appreciate that, which is less so other places.
And did the Americans laugh somewhere where you were surprised and
shocked? Yeah. No, I wasn't shocked, but there's this part where he asked for medicine to cure him being gay.
Mm-hmm.
Where Americans laugh more than the Danes did.
Mm.
Yeah.
So now it's coming to theaters and to streaming, I assume, at some point down the road. But people have a chance to see the movie. Are you at the end of that journey at this point emotionally, or are you waiting for a moment to happen where a bigger, wider audience gets to actually see the film and engage it?
No, but I look forward to see, you know, because now it's out in Denmark,
mm-hmm.
it's out in Sweden, but it's very local premieres.
Uh-huh.
So to see it hit like a big market like the US, and also, you know, in the UK or France, to have like a big market to see how people will react to it. I'm really looking forward to that.
And what will the landmarks be for you? I mean, is it? I assume it's not financial.
No. No, it's just it's basically the reception and see if people who are not, you know, the normal kind of animated documentary audience, people who are, yeah, the broad audience, if they will go see it and how their reception will be.
Have you had any bad responses?
Very few. But I've had few. There's some people who felt that, you know, the animation distances them from the real story. But that's mostly it.
But they wouldn't really get the story if it weren't for the animation, it seems like.
No.
It wouldn't exist.
It wouldn't exist.
And in terms of the storytelling, is he... Did you animate him as he was always in terms of your interviews? Or some of it creating a different situation, but it looks like the interview, you know, the same spot he's sitting in?
No, it's very close to reality. We changed a little bit, but, you know, because it's animation, so we changed a little bit.
Right.
But it's very close to how things actually were. And you know, I shot everything, so we had the real footage to kind of as a reference for the animation. So it's very close.
Are you done with this format, or are you looking forward to working in it again?
I don't know. Like, if the right project comes along, sure. I really think that there's something special with animated documentaries. So I don't have another animated project on my hands, but
Well, I mean, you're in a position now where people will be looking for your next film.
Yeah.
So, I mean, are you thinking, okay, I'll just do a different... Do you want to do a completely different kind of film, a different kind of very different subject, or where do you want to go?
I think in my core, I really like telling stories about people who are marginalized somehow. So I think I'm going to keep down that path. The format, I don't know. We'll see. I think as long as I have the story, then I'll find a format that kind of fits the story. But it can be documentary, it can be animation, can be.
Well,
a
you
mix.
Shot this movie, so yeah. Besides the animation,
yeah.
So,
and it could also be narrative live action. I don't feel I have boundaries in that sense. Also, like when I went to school, I did narrative stuff, so.
And you don't feel compelled to go in any one direction or a different direction or any of that kind of thing?
No, I think if I was going to do another documentary, it really needs to be a strong story. Because it's tough making documentaries. You have a double responsibility, you know, that you don't have when doing fiction. Because you have a responsibility towards the project and also towards the subject, which is... They don't always align, so it's always like a fine balance to find, okay, the right place to do it.
So if you do a narrative, would it be a Dutch narrative as opposed to a Hollywood
Danish.
Narrative, do you think? A Danish narrative.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I'm
no.
Always doing that kind of thing.
That's very
would
common.
It be a Danish narrative as opposed to a, you know, looking for a Hollywood studio to, you know, make your next movie?
It really comes down to the story. So if the right story comes around, I could do both. But it really comes down to if there's a strong story that.
Surf the waves.
Yes.
It was funny because Ari Folman has this new film on Anne Frank.
Yeah.
And my son and I read the Anne Frank book, the graphic novel that he did. It's completely different than the movie he ended up making. It was kind of like shocking.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, they're both great, but in very different ways.
Yeah.
Very different structure.
I've seen the graphic novel. I haven't read it entirely, but it looks beautiful. But
yeah.
I haven't seen the film yet. I'm really looking forward
well, they're
to it.
Visually similar, but they're it's a just a different the device he uses in the film. Of the, you know, the ghost friend is not in the book at all.
Okay.
So it was kind of surprising.
Yeah.
But I guess that's the thing, is you have the freedom to wonder where you want to wander.
Yeah.
So are you taking meetings in LA?
I have a couple of meetings, yeah. But I've done a lot since Sundance, you know.
Yeah.
I've had a lot on Zoom, but
Well, it's been like a huge movement in the last number of years to get documentary filmmakers to make narrative cinema.
Yeah.
It seems to be like the people they want to hire to do these things.
Yeah.
Do you mind being away from home for a long period of time?
If I can bring my family, that's fine.
You can bring them?
Yeah.
So you don't want to go? You're going to go to Budapest and shoot an action movie?
I don't know about an action movie. It really, again, depends on the story. If the story is right, I will go very fast to make it happen.
And you seem very kind of placid about the whole thing in terms of, like, it doesn't seem like you're whatever happens in the next few weeks in terms of the release of the movie, it seems like you're kind of at peace with the whole thing.
Yeah, I think so. I can't do anything about it. Like, the film is done. It's whatever happens is going to happen. I can't really change that. I look forward to having the film reach its audience and being there to witness that. But
there are very few directors who believe they can't actually control the world. So.
Oh, yeah?
They all seem to believe somehow.
Yeah. Yeah, no. I don't think I can control it.
Well, then I'm glad you're not controlling it. Because yeah. It's going pretty well with you controlling it at this point. For you, at least. With your film. Yeah. Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Pleasure.